Hello everyone, thank you for tuning in. We are here today with Jeanne de Kroon, founder of Zazi Vintage. She's a fashion, an eco-fashion warrior, and she's a lover of life, I think. If you don't know Jeanne, she has a beautiful clothing brand and she works with families from rural India, Uzbekistan and Afghanistan. And she loves clothing, she loves fabrics, and she loves the people.
Welcome, Jeanne. Thank you for joining us today.
Oh, thank you so much. I'm so happy to be here. Thank you for facilitating this incredible community.
Yes, it's our pleasure. You know, lots of people out there who are watching this might not know so much about you, or they might as well, but most of them have probably heard of Zazi Vintage, your brand. We have seen you being interviewed previously and you talk a lot about that Zazi is not you. Zazi is the women who you employed to make the clothing. However, Zazi is still an idea and a conception that came from you. So what we really want to know is how much of Jeanne is in Zazi? And what of Jeanne is in Zazi?
That's such a good question. So Zazi is like, I would definitely say it's like a community or a platform to facilitate women's stories and how they relate to both culture, to nature, to spirit through cloth. So I feel like, you know, clothing, I think as we know it, it's always this like the industry right now is like really good in like making up stories, but clothing itself always used to have such incredible stories. And I come myself from like a weaver's family. So I think this is like the interwoven thread throughout my life is try to like rediscover this connective wisdom that women have to their clothing. So Zazi as itself, because we work with so many different, I mean, incredible women's communities from Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, Afghanistan and India. And I really wanted to create a platform to try to facilitate their stories because they're still so strong in their way of ancestral craft, which we've really lost in like the global north. And I think how much of me is in there, I think it's probably my enthusiasm, but also like it's, I think Zazi in the way it manifests right now is also like personifying my personal process of decolonization. It's personifying my personal process of how can I really co-create intentionally. So how can I take myself away as like a designer working with a factory, but how can we come together as like women being like, okay, we have this chance now to co-create a story together, to weave a story together. So I try to sort of, I guess, be like the, build the container for that. I would see myself as a, like a space facilitator, but not necessarily as a prime entity in the community.
As a figurehead.
And do you create the designs yourself, or do the women also help you with that?
Yeah, I mean, that's the most incredible thing because we work with so many talented artisans. For example, you know, like the ikat weaving in Uzbekistan, we have it all across, you know, the Silk Road, but it's incredible to hear like the processes behind it and like the ways and the figures and the symbols and like all the sort of the wisdom behind it. So I think as a brand, we definitely come up with like, okay, you know, we're going to fall winter. So we want to have like more like, let's say, brownish tones that like resemble, you know, the fall colors. But then actually it's been such a beautiful process to connect directly to the women and say like, okay, you know, what's in season? Because I think often, especially when you use natural dyes, you don't really take in mind that, you know, just like food, like fashion is also has to be seasonal. Like you can only produce like an organic cotton cycle X amount of times. And the same is with, let's say, you know, like the onion skins or the turmeric or, you know, the avocado pits that you use for the dyeing process. So I think we really come together as like women and ask each other like, okay, so what's in season? What kind of story do you want to translate or facilitate to the world? And how can we then facilitate, you know, within the design process? So I definitely have like a rough shape in mind. But then that moment of co-creation is like this process of 6 months and coming together, asking questions, sending pictures of babies and
collaboration.
Lots of joy.
Wow. Yeah, we know that.
And what meaning does fabrics, clothing, cloth, what does this have in your life on a daily basis, and what kind of rituals do you create around those things for yourself?
Such a good question as well. Thank you so much for asking these beautiful questions. Let's see. Well, I think for me, like clothing is like a woven story. So I think it's for me, like when I get dressed up in the morning or when I dress myself, like I connect or I try to resonate with the story of the clothing, whether that is like personifying a moment that I connected to it first in my life, or now that I know more of cloth and the stories, especially that I wear, I try to be really be, for example, we work with, you know, Suzani, and like there's so much intricate like wisdom and knowledge that is translated into the codes that I now know. You can almost read them as like, you know, a love letter from mother to daughter. So I think I try to, with everything, be more intentional with my life, you know, whether it is the food that I eat every morning, or I have, you know, I have rescue hens. So when they gave me an egg, you know, when they give me an egg every morning, I'm just like, oh, thank you. You know, I think just have that connectivity to the world and that intentionality makes life so much more rich. And same as with the clothing that I wear. And it doesn't really matter, you know, if it's really, it shouldn't, you can make your own rules. With the clothing, and I think that's the beauty of it. And it's like every day I feel like it's such a amazing way to celebrate being a woman.
Wonderful.
Yeah, that's really nicely spoken, I would say. Mm-hmm. Right.
And if you had to boil them down into three primary values that drive you in your life, what would they be, and how have they helped you create the person that you are today?
My top three values, I think first and foremost, I am driven by the incredible like connective wisdom that women have naturally, whether that is through cloth or to each other. I think there's such a sisterhood in the world, and I think that's really what I want to try and facilitate through Zazi, but also in many other different ways. I think, you know, we've suffered from like so many like hundreds of years of patriarchy, of colonization, of, you know, like a really imbalanced sort of masculine and feminine in society. And I feel like by rediscovering that and not seeing the competition, not seeing the pain, but more being like, okay, how can we create this container or this space to really welcome this sisterhood and like have each other flourish? I think that's the thing that mostly drives me.
Lift each other up.
Lift each other up, definitely, absolutely, in every single way. So I think that's what mostly drives me. And I think whenever I meet a woman, I'm just like, I'm just like, feel such a sparkle in my heart. I'm just like, oh, who are you? You know, what drives you? What can I learn from you? So I think that's what mostly drives me in my life. And then, all the things that are connected to women, well, from my perception, which is their incredible power, their care, their love and willpower. I mean, yeah, just I can talk hours when I talk about women and what they mean to me.
Would you say a value of yours is also helping people less fortunate, or creating a platform or a voice for them, or creating possibility or potential for them in the world?
Yeah, definitely. I think help is a hard word, because I feel like it for me, it's been more like, you know, like when I'm in the village, it's just, or when I'm in the villages that I work with, it's just like they're helping us to reconnect. I think we are incredibly spiritually and connectively deprived in the global north. And
yeah,
I think
so it's actually the,
so
other,
it's
way
actually
around.
The other way around. Yeah, yeah, totally. Yeah. I think it's just sort of like,
well, we're lifting each other.
It's yeah.
Having a connection.
Totally. We like lift each other up. Yeah. And I think, yeah, there's not a day in the Zazi world that I don't learn from some woman in some area of the world. And I'm just absolutely like shaken to my core of the power that we have and the role that we play. The ability to see people, I think.
See people as in who they truly are.
Who they truly are and what they represent. And I think this is what drives me mostly, because I think I'm like inherently, you know, Zazi is a community of women collaborators. And I think, you know, like we can flourish the most when we're seen in our creativity, in the way that we stand into the world. And I think that's what mostly drives me. And I think to try to create a platform where everybody's seen and can flourish in the best way.
Would it be correct in saying that you also see potential, not just what they've brought to date, but
totally
what they are capable of?
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely. I think it's grace. Because I feel like the way women naturally are, like whether they sort of embody their very raw feminine or they're sort of, you know, like more made up or put together, I think there is such an incredible grace to women when they're in their power.
So, Jeanne, how do you find the women and families that you work with?
Yes. Well, it started, I think, as many things in life, they sort of came on my path. But with Madhu, like I got, she's like my sister. She's from India, and she like set up this incredible community called the Saheli Women, which translates in Hindi as like the girlfriend club. So we found each other. Yeah, it's so nice, and it really feels like it.
And it's an incredible story.
God, she is one of the most incredible humans that I ever connected to, and she really made me start my company initially. She just started out, and I just started out, and we made the first dresses from like upcycled fabrics. But right now we've also started to partner up with the United Nations Ethical Fashion Initiative, which is a joint venture of the United Nations and the World Trade Organization, to facilitate the incredible like artisanal projects, but also like rural farmers communities into the international market. So we partner with them in Afghanistan, Uzbekistan, and Tajikistan. So that's how we found these partners. And then I think just like, you know, like what you probably have as well with Nourish, like once you start with the right intention, it just seems like the right people sort of come and align on your path and find you. So yeah, now we have so many beautiful women as well, like reaching out of like, oh, I have this project, you know, let's create something together. And I think that's ultimately what I really want to have. It's like a global sisterhood of stories of craft and connection.
Yeah, you probably find the same, that we find that energy attracts energy.
And so absolutely.
The more energy you get around a project, the more it attracts more.
Absolutely.
In as well.
And every
single
way.
More you put it out there,
yeah,
it all comes to you. But that's also interesting, I think, because then I think to switch to our story, maybe a little bit, the skincare. Like, how did you, when did you start your natural beauty journey?
My natural beauty journey. Well, I think just like a lot of girls that grow up in the global north, you have a certain perception of beauty and a certain perception of like what is what you should look like as a woman. I got into modeling when I was 18. And I think I just found myself just, you know, like filled with chemicals and in like a polyester dress in like a New York situation. And I
sweating.
Remember just like very sweaty, very much pimples. And I was just like, whoa, this is not the glamour that
that's
I sort of,
glamour.
You know, looked up in the magazines. And I think I also just saw this picture. I remember I was one shot for this US magazine. And I think I literally looked at a picture from that day and from the magazine. I was just like, like no wonder we're all so like, you know, like inherently there's so much self-hate and
insecure.
There's so much insecurity around, you know, what it means to be a woman, because, you know, not even the girls that are in magazines look like the magazines. And I think that's the sort of thing, like beauty and makeup, I think that's very inherently something that, you know, comes across all cultures and all different shapes and forms. So I think that's not the thing that is the problem. I think it's more like the conditioning around the framework and like taking like not having that as a choice, but as a need from society. And I think for me, natural beauty is probably started like a lot of things. I think when I was 19, there were a lot of things that were very disconnected. So I was like, okay, so modeling is not the thing. The clothing that I'm wearing is not actually the thing. I don't know what I should do, who I should be as being a woman in society. So I ended up in this really dark place, also just where I should go. And then I think at some point I started to like de-strip everything away and try to figure out like, how can I build up on that space? And that's also, you know, I had incredibly bad acne when I was younger. So for me, it really helped to just like stop the chemicals on my face. And then
the layers of makeup.
And
too,
the layers
right?
of makeup. And then I started to also learn about, you know, the beauty industry. And I think that's when it really just hit to me, where I was just like, why am I putting all of these like super heavy chemicals on a daily basis? You know, and I think that's what you don't notice, you know, like that's the same thing with the tampons that we put in. That's the same things with, you know, it's just like, oh my God, I'm putting like genetically modified, you know, like cotton in my vagina. I'm like putting in like heavy toxic chemicals, you know, on my eyelids. Mm-hmm. And I'm like eating probably like, you know, so many of it per year in my mouth and my system. Like, no wonder my system is breaking out. No wonder my body is screaming that she needs help. So I think I started probably a few years ago trying to really rediscover, but then I'm so happy that you created this platform, because I think, especially when you're based in Holland, it's just like sometimes really hard to try to figure out, okay, so what's good? How does it work? When I just start with organic beauty, I think there were just a few brands on the market in Europe, and it sort of like stuck for like 10 minutes and then it went away. So it's like,
yeah, and it's a little bit the same as fashion, right? Yeah. Some brands are very hard to read. So
definitely,
you have to do
this
a lot
greenwashing across everything. Yeah.
Across yeah. every market.
Yeah. So yeah. That's probably really hard when you start with natural beauty, and definitely yeah. in the Netherlands, because it wasn't that common.
No.
So, yeah, you're not going to stand and read every single
every
ingredient.
Single ingredient.
And,
no, totally.
Yeah.
But most people can't even decipher what an ingredient list is. It's difficult for us. I have 2 science degrees, and it's difficult for me
totally.
Sometimes to read an ingredient panel
on a
skincare product. But I think you really touched on an important point that a lot of women, especially, I mean, all women of all ages forget, and that's that our body's a biological organism.
Totally.
It's literally its own ecosystem.
Yeah.
And your skin is a living, breathing jacket.
Yeah.
We wonder why we have acne. We wonder why we have health problems. Yet we cover it and fill it with chemicals.
Yeah.
How can
Absolutely.
It survive like this? A plant wouldn't survive covered in chemicals. So how do we expect our own
bodies to do so?
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, I think this is often what we forget, like our own microbiome is in a constant conversation with what's on top of it.
Absolutely.
And that's even with the clothing that you wear, you know, like if you wear polyester or like some sort of like synthetic or chemical dyes even, you know, just something so simple, like that's actually literally like on top of your biggest organ, which is your skin, which is constantly then...
Well, both of us, we can't wear any synthetic stuff because we are stinkers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No,
it's
I'm
true.
Not joking. It's
our
true.
Body literally stinks.
Just,
as
it's
soon
just
as we
like
wear
totally.
It's like
so we have to wear like.
I'm so glad we told everyone.
Yeah, absolutely. No, but it comes across. I think we're in a similar thing. So I think
we just have to put it out there and help other women.
Yeah. Help other women. And what's your favorite Nourish product?
Oh my god! Let me say, I really love the Inika.
Mm-hmm.
Is that, yeah, how I pronounce it properly. I really love their mascara. I think I just fell in love with this amazing called Sacred Earth.
The Sacred Earth palette.
So nice. I have it everywhere on my skin right now.
It's beautiful.
It's so beautiful.
I of course make that in Byron Bay.
And then I have a really good friend that has like the most incredible like dry shampoo, which is really helpful for me. She's called Romy, and she did a really beautiful collaboration with you guys.
Yes.
And she has like the best... dry shampoo, because I think that's always what I struggled with. And it's just with herbs. Like, I looked at the ingredients and I was just like, wow, like I would even like put this on my salad.
You could almost eat it. Please don't, but you could.
No, I
could
almost eat it.
Okay. Thank
Sorry,
you so much.
No,
thank you so much for joining us today
yes.
and bringing your beautiful smile and your wonderful energy.
Thank
you,
you
for
so
your contribution
too.
To the world and for loving what
and
we love. And thank you for the beauty. Yeah. It's been a pleasure having
Same.
You with us.
Yeah. Such a gift.
Goodbye, everyone.
Goodbye.
We'll see you next time.
Bye.